Good afternoon, all. A warm welcome to Suryapet Khammam Bioscience online class. I am Kausar Anjum, working as DGT Science in TSMS Imampet Village, Suryapet Mandalay District. Today I am here with the topic chemical fertilizers. In previous sessions, you have learned about fertilizers, natural fertilizers, in that you have learned about the compost and panchagavya. Okay. And I think you have known what are fertilizers. So I'll teach you in this class the chemical fertilizers. So when I finish my class, what are the learning outcomes? Let's have a glance. Here, after my class, you can define the term fertilizer and its types with examples. That means what is fertilizer, how many types of fertilizers, and you can also cite examples, and you can give information on the presence of various nutrient percentages in different chemical fertilizers. In which chemical fertilizer, how many, what is the percentage of nitrogen, what is the percentage of phosphorus and potassium, you can give that information, and you can give reason for various questions. So what those questions are: which is the best time and best way to provide fertilizers to plants? And do all variety of plants require same quantity of fertilizers for the increase in their production? So these are the learning outcomes. After my class, you will be able to know these things. So let's begin our session with the term fertilizers. So already you are familiar with the term fertilizer. Once again, I'll recapitulate it for you. Fertilizer is a substance which increase or which enhance the growth and productivity of plants Those substances are called as fertilizers. Fertilizers are the substances which enhances the growth and productivity of the plants. So how many types of fertilizers do we have? Means generally we have categorized fertilizers into two types. Those are natural fertilizers, and the second are the artificial fertilizers. So depending upon what we have categorized, means depending upon their origination. I mean from where these fertilizers are derived, whether these are derived from the organic substances or a combination of organic and inorganic or completely inorganic. So these are divided into two types, that is natural fertilizers and the artificial fertilizers. Here, there are some examples for the natural fertilizers, that is manure, panchagavya, and vermicompost. Many more are also there, like blood meal, bone meal. Okay, but here I have given only three as the examples. And coming to the artificial fertilizers, there are the three examples I have taken. One is urea. The other is NPK, in the sense nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. And the third one is superphosphate. So I hope you have understood the definition of fertilizers and how many types of fertilizers are there. Now I am showing here on the screen, you are able to see some of the pictures which are the examples of the natural fertilizers. This is the cow manure, this is the bone meal, vermicompost, and this is a manure, and this is a compost pit. Compit in the sense a hole which is dug in the soil. So we have how the compost is prepared. A pit is dug, and in that all the wastage, plants and animal wastage, will be added. Later the pit is covered with the soil and sprinkled with water. Okay, after a few weeks, what happens? The wastage will be, the organic wastage what we have added will be converted into, will be decomposed by the soil bacteria and fungus, and will be converted into the compost, which are rich in nutrients, which enhances the growth of the plants and even the productivity of the plants. And if you see this manure, this is the picture you mostly come across while you are on the way to the villages, isn't it? So there will be the heaps, this dry grass, which is called as hay, and also the cow dung, and it will be left for so many weeks so that it can get decomposed by the soil organisms, and it can be converted into the natural fertilizer, which we named as manure. Okay, So these are the examples of the natural fertilizers. Now we will move to the our main topic, that is chemical fertilizers. Chemical fertilizers can also be named as artificial fertilizers, and it can also be called as synthetic fertilizers. So why these are named as synthetic or artificial fertilizers means these are man-made. Okay, these are not natural in their origin. These are prepared by the human being by taking either organic substances, few of the organic substances and few of the inorganic substances, or completely by taking the inorganic substances. So chemical fertilizers are partially or completely synthetic in origin. How they are formed, origin in the sense how they are born or how they are developed. They are developed by mixing of both organic and inorganic substances, or only by taking of inorganic substances. So these are the chemical fertilizers. Mostly you will find in fertilizers shops, so you will be seeing these type of bags, isn't it? So those are urea, NPK, superphosphate, and many more will be there. So these are the chemical fertilizers. Now, here there is a question displayed on the screen, that is, what happens to the nutrients in the soil when the plants grow continuously in it? When the plants grow continuously in the soil, what happens to the nutrients? Okay, what happens? Just think. The nutrients go on depleting in the soil. Deplete in the sense go on exhausting, go on decreasing. It will get vanished from the soil, isn't it? When the plants grow, they take the nutrients from the soil. So what happens to the nutrients in the soil? The nutrients will get decreased. Then what happens? What happens to the soil when there are no nutrients in the soil? Soil becomes sterile. Sterile. It is the opposite of fertile. Okay, where sterile in the sense of the soil which cannot support the growth of the plants. The soil which doesn't have any nutrients required for the plant growth, such a type of soil is called as sterile soil. Opposite of the sterile is fertile. Okay, sagu bhumi, banjaru bhumi we call in Telugu. And what happens then if the soil becomes sterile? The plants cannot grow, isn't it? When the soil becomes sterile, plants cannot grow. If the plants cannot grow, what will be the consequences? We cannot get the food, isn't it? And along with the food, we cannot get many other plant-originated products. Do we get only food from the plant? No. We get so many other products. You are familiar with this in your sixth, you are learning this from your sixth and seventh standards. The importance of forest, isn't it? So, because when we go on growing the plants in the soil, slowly the nutrients in the soil decreases, which makes the soil sterile. Further, it cannot support the plant growth. And finally, we will not get the food and also many other products which we generally get from the plants. And most of above all, cannot get the oxygen, which is a basic need for our survival, isn't it? So our life is whole and soul dependent on the plants. So we have to save plants. Next. So here the question is given, how can be the nutrients added back to the soil? We are going on, we are planting the trees, and the trees are going by absorbing the nutrients from the soil. Slowly the nutrients get decreased in the soil. So how can we add those nutrients back into the soil? This is a very, very important question we have to think over, isn't it? So here, the ways by which the soil replenishes their nutrients are as follows. Replenish means which can be renewed, which can be added back. So how the nutrients are added back into the soil? By the two ways. The first one is through living organisms in the soil and through dead plant and animal bodies. Okay, so there are the two ways by which, there are many other ways also, but mostly there are two ways. That is, the most microorganisms which are present in the soil are helpful for adding back of the nutrients into the soil. And the second one is dead by the dead plants and animal bodies. So here, these are the organisms which are helpful for the adding of nutrients back to the soil. These are the beetles. These beetles make holes in the soil. I mean, they make burrows in the soil, and which makes a soil which is under, which is at the lower surface to come up. Okay, like this, the different layers of the soil gets rotated so that the soil can become aerated. I mean, so the air can easily pass into the soil and the soil becomes aerated. So these are the beetles which are helpful for the aeration of the soil, which increases the structure of the soil. And these are the mushrooms, which is a part of or which is a type of fungus. It is also very important for the soil as it grows on the dead and decaying organic matter. And these are the earthworms. Already you have known its importance. Earthworms also live in the soil and makes the soil fertile. And these are the most important, that is the bacteria. And along with this, fungus will also be there. These will decompose the dead and decaying organic matter and adds the nutrients back into the soil. See here, the second is the by dead animals and dead plants, isn't it? So how the dead animals and dead plants are helpful in the sense, generally plants grow by taking nutrients from the soil. Then the nutrients decreases in the soil, isn't it? When the plants grow and when they die, again, those nutrients are added back to the soil. So how these are added back in the sense here, the major role is done by the bacteria and the fungus. The soil bacteria and the fungus which are present will decompose the plant bodies into the soil so that again, these nutrients can be get mixed into the soil. And as the most of the animals, almost all the animals directly or indirectly depends upon the plants, isn't it? So these plants, these animals, when they die, again, those bodies get decomposed by the bacteria and the fungus. And again, the nutrients are added back into the soil. So these are the two ways by which the soil is replenished with their nutrients. Okay, now we will see here. Do all the fertilizers possess same percent of nutrients? Here, a list of fertilizers are given. Urea, superphosphate, ammonium sulfate, and potassium nitrate. So these do all these contain the same amount of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium? Let's see. See here, urea, it has only nitrogen. That is 46% of the nitrogen is present in the urea. And there are no phosphorus and potassium in the urea. And coming to the superphosphate, there is no nitrogen in the superphosphate. The name itself shows only the phosphorus is present. So how much percent of phosphorus is present means 8 to 9% of the phosphorus is present. And there is no potassium is seen in the superphosphate fertilizer. And the third one is ammonium sulfate. Ammonium sulfate, it has 21% of nitrogen, whereas phosphorus and potassium are absent here. And coming to the potassium nitrate. So here, the name itself has potassium and nitrogen. Nitrogen, it makes to 13% and potassium makes to 44%. So various fertilizers have various percentage of nutrients. So here one more question is given. Can we add all these nutrients in the soil at once? Or how can we come to know which fertilizer must be added in the soil? Okay, if you consult a farmer, you will get the proper answer for this. I will also try to give the answer for that. See here, how can we come to know which nutrient is required in the soil, which nutrient is sufficient in the soil, and which nutrient is a deficit in the soil? This can be known by the soil testing. Okay, so we have to give our soil for the testing. The agricultural department, those they will test the soil and they will give us the report on our soil, that what is the status of our soil. Whether our soil is enough, whether the soil has enough nutrients or which nutrient is in less quantity, what to be added, everything will, this information will be provided by the agricultural extension officers and the agricultural officer. Okay, I hope you have understood. So various fertilizers and the nutrient percent in them. And next to the second, the next concept, that is how can we know that how can we get the information about the various factors, what factors to be considered to get the maximum yield. See here, when we grow plants, I mean when we grow crops, we grow the crops to get the yield, isn't it? That is the main target. So how we have to we should have some information about the various factors so that we can get the maximum yield. So here there are the three factors on which we have to get the information to get the maximum yield from our crop. That is the amount of nutrients finally available to the plant. See here, we will supply so many nutrients, so many fertilizers to our soil. So how can we know that whether those nutrients are getting absorbed by the soil getting absorbed by the plants or not? How can we know that? We have to know that information, and we have to know the remaining two we should have the information about these two factors also. What is the best time to provide nutrients, when we have to provide the nutrients, and which is the best way to add the nutrients to the soil. So we have to get the complete information about these three factors in order to get the maximum yield from our crop. So here we are adding so many fertilizers, isn't it? But how can we come to know whether the plant is gaining all the required nutrients in required quantities? How can we know? Just by seeing the plant, can we know? Yes, we have to observe the plant structure, its plant parts. So what we have to observe means if the plants are not getting all the required nutrients, then there will be very little growth, or there will be no growth at all in the plants. So if the plants are not growing, or if the plants are growing very in a very slow rate, then it is the indication that the plants are not getting their required amount of nutrients. And dead tissue is found at the leaf tips or edges. So here the plant gets, the leaves get wrinkled at its tip or leaf edges, and yellow or dead leaves only at one part of the plant. The total plant will be green, but one part of the plant will totally gets dried or turns to yellow. So here these leaves are fresh, isn't it? But here some of the leaves are getting dried. So this is also one of the symptom which shows that the plants are not getting proper nutrients. And we can also find yellow or white streaks in between the leaf veins. So here this is the leaf, and this is the midrib, and these are the veins. So in between the veins you can find yellow streaks, yellow lines, streaks in the sense lines, or white lines. So all these are the observations we have to make. If any of these are present in the plant, then we can determine that the plant is not getting all the required nutrients. So what the nutrients we are supplying to the soil is not gained by the plant. So we have to think on this, and we have to get the proper, we have to find the proper solution for that. Next, which is the best time to provide nutrients? So it is a morning time. Morning time is the best time to provide nutrients. Why it is a morning time? In the sense, the temperature will be less, and also there will be no speed winds. When the speed winds are present, most of the nutrients will get rushed to other places. So because of these two factors, we have to provide the nutrients in the morning time. And what is the best way to provide nutrients to the plants means by placing fertilizers under the soil is the one. And second is dissolving fertilizers in the water. Okay, so we have to place the fertilizers under the soil. Okay, there are again two types. We can place superficially under the soil, or it can be deeply placed under the soil. And the second one is the dissolving fertilizers in the water, so the water can easily absorbed by the plants. Sprinkling of fertilizers is it should not be much preferred. Okay, and next here there is a again a question given. That is it necessary that the production of all the crops increases equally if an equal amount of nutrients are supplied? When you supply all the nutrients equally to all the varieties of plants, is there any surety that all the plants will grow and give the maximum yield? So let's check this by observing this graph 3, which is given in the page number 119 in your textbook. So this graph 3 shows what is the effect of nutrients on various varieties of rice crop. So here this here the graph shows x-axis and the y-axis. Okay, so the x-axis shows the amount of nitrogen applied in kgs per hectare. Okay, and this y-axis shows the crop yield in ton per hectare. So here the two varieties of rice are taken. That is, one is IR8 and second is PETA. So on these two varieties, one experiment was done by supplying the equal quantity of nitrogen, and the yield was recorded after supplying of various quantities of the nitrogen. So here this table shows the result that when no nitrogen is supplied, then IR8 variety has given 4.8 ton of rice, whereas the PETA variety has given 5.2 ton. That means when nitrogen is not given at all, this variety is giving more yield when compared to this variety. And when 40 kgs of nitrogen is supplied, then the yield was increased in the IR8 variety, that is 6 ton. And here in this variety also the yield was increased, that is 5.8 ton. And when the nitrogen is supplied in further more quantity, that is 120 kgs of nitrogen when it was supplied, then the yield in the IR8 was 8.4 ton. So the yield was going on constantly increasing, whereas in this variety the yield was decreased, that is only just 4 ton. If you see here, this blue line shows IR8 and whereas this pink line shows the PETA variety. And if you see the line, it is constantly increasing. That means when the nitrogen fertilizer is supplied, IR8 variety is going on giving more yield. When the nitrogen was not supplied at all, then the yield was more given by the PETA. And when the nitrogen was given, when the quantity was given and given in large quantities, slowly the yield was decreased in the PETA. So by this we can say that the amount of nitrogen when it is supplied to two different varieties, the yield is not similar. Every person if you observe the human beings also, every person has their unique requirement, isn't it? All the human beings are not similar in any of the factor. They are not similar. In the same way, rice plants or any other plants are also, all the varieties are different and they have their unique qualities. Okay, I hope you have understood this. And here, after analyzing the graph, you have analyzed the graph in the previous slide, isn't it? You can say that crop production always continue. Can you say that the crop production always continue to increase as we go on adding more and more quantities of nitrogenous fertilizers? No, we cannot say that. After analyzing the graph, we have come to the conclusion that few of the varieties can give more yield on adding more nitrogenous fertilizers, whereas few cannot give more yield. Okay, or can give more yield to some extent. After that, if you go on adding more and more nitrogen, the yield slowly decreases. So you have to remember this. Next, is it advisable to add only nitrogenous fertilizers? What effect will this have on other nutrients in the soil? Is it advisable to add only nitrogenous fertilizers? No. In the previous slide, I explained to you that only after the soil testing, we can come to know which nutrient is in excess quantity, which nutrient is in sufficient quantity, and which nutrient is in deficit amount, isn't it? So after getting that information only, we can add. If we add only nitrogenous fertilizers, then the phosphorus and the potassium quantities may decrease. So all the nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium have their own role in the crop growth, isn't it? So the nitrogen, what happens? It will cue early. It will help in the fast growth of leaves and flowers. And phosphorus helps in the deep penetration of the roots so that the water can be absorbed from the deep layers of the soil. And potassium helps in the increase of resistance power of the plant, and also it enhances the quality of the smell, taste of the fruit. So every nutrient has its own importance. So only nitrogenous fertilizer, if we give, the remaining two will not show its effect on the soil. So after soil testing only, we have to provide the nutrient which are less in the soil. Next, now it is the time for the evaluation. So here, what is a fertilizer? Describe about the types of fertilizers. So fertilizers are the substances which enhances the growth and productivity of a plant, isn't it? And how many types of fertilizers are there? There are two types of fertilizer. The first is natural fertilizer, and second is the artificial fertilizer. Artificial fertilizer can also be called as synthetic fertilizer or chemical fertilizer. And the next question is, write few examples for natural and chemical fertilizers. For natural fertilizers, we can give so many examples. That is manure, compost, green manure, and we can give vermicompost, panchagavya. And if for chemical fertilizers, we can give the example as urea, NPK, superphosphate, ammonium nitrate. So many more we can give. And coming to the third question, which is the best time and best way to provide nutrients to the plants? Give reason. So which is the best time, children? It is a morning time. So why it is the best to give the fertilizer in the morning time? What is the reason in the sense? In the morning, the temperature is less, and also the speed of the winds will also be low. So because of these two reasons, we have to provide the nutrients in the morning time. And what is the best way? Should we sprinkle it, or should we dissolve it in the water and should we provide it, or should we place the fertilizer under the soil so that the roots can absorb it? So which is among these three, which is the best one? Well, the most preferred one is we have to give the fertilizer, we have to place the fertilizers under the soil. And this is also preferable, that providing the fertilizer along with the water. And coming to the fourth question, can the amount of nutrient determine the productivity of a plant? Can the amount of nutrient determine the productivity of the plant? No. The amount of nutrient cannot determine the productivity of the plant. Here in that graph we have seen, that means all the varieties cannot give the equal yield. Some of the varieties gives more yield with the supply of more nitrogenous fertilizers, and some varieties can give less yield. And if there are, so sometimes it can determine also if nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium are present in the equal quantities, definitely the yield will be more. So we have to write both the faces of the sides of this, for both the answers for this question. Next, depending upon the situation, the answer is dependent. So you can write, you can give both the answers. So here, how can we say that plants are not gaining their required nutrients? So how can we say that the plants are not gaining their required nutrients? Means by the observation of the external plant structure. So by observing its leaves, okay. So mostly, if the plant growth is low, or if the plant is not at all growing, then it indicates that the plant is not gaining all the required nutrients. This is the first thing. And the second thing is by observing the leaves of the plants. If the leaf edges and the tips are becoming yellow in color and getting wilted, then this is also shows that the plants are not getting the proper nutrients. And by also observing the plant parts, if all the plant parts are green in color, and if only few areas of the plants are becoming brown or yellow in color and becoming dry, then this shows that plants are not getting all the required nutrients in the sufficient amounts. So I hope you have understood all this topic, and go through the content which is given in your textbook, frame your own questions, answer those questions, and get it evaluated from your teachers. Okay, meet you. Thank you for watching my class. Meet you soon in the next class with a new topic.